Good afternoon. We're now on the 2nd of February, and I'm going to be reading day 32, which is a day late, but it doesn't matter, does it, as long as it's read and out there. So for today, I'm going to be reading Exodus 12 to 14, Psalm 32, Matthew 15, verses 21 to 39. I just better make sure that I didn't record it already, because I haven't got any notes here that I did. So I know I made a mistake the other day. So, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. A reading from Exodus 12. Yahweh said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, "This month must be the first of all the months for you, the first month of your year. Speak to the whole community of Israel and say, 'On the 10th day of this month, each man must take an animal from the flock for his family. One animal for each household. If the household is too small for the animal, he must join with his neighbor nearest to his house, depending on the number of persons. When you choose the animal, you will take into account what each must eat or can eat. It must be an animal without blemish, a male 1 year old. You may choose it either from the sheep or from the goats. You must keep it till the 14th day of the month, when the whole assembly of the community of Israel will slaughter it at twilight. Some of the blood must then be taken and put on both doorposts and the lintel of the houses where it is eaten. That night the flesh must be eaten, roasted over the fire. It must be eaten with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over the fire with the head, feet, and entrails. You must not leave any of it over till the morning. Whatever is left till morning, you must burn. This is how you must eat it: with a belt round your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. You must eat it hurriedly. It is a Passover in Yahweh God's honor. That night I shall go through Egypt and strike down all the firstborn in Egypt, man and beast alike, and shall execute justice on all the gods of Egypt. I, Yahweh. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are. When I see the blood, I shall pass over you, and you will escape the destructive plague when I strike Egypt. This day must be commemorated by you, and you must keep it as a feast in Yahweh God's honor. You must keep it as a feast day for all generations. This is a decree for all time. The Feast of Unleavened Bread. For 7 days you must eat unleavened bread. On the first day you must clean the leaven out of your houses. For anyone who eats leavened bread from the first to the seventh day must be outlawed from Israel. On the first day, you must hold a sacred assembly, and on the seventh day, a sacred assembly. On those days, no work may be done. You will prepare only what each requires to eat. You must keep the feast of unleavened bread, because it was on that same day that I brought your armies out of Egypt. You will keep that day generation after generation. This is a decree for all time. In the first month, from the evening of the 14th day until the evening of the 21st day, you must eat unleavened bread. For 7 days there may be no leaven in your houses, since anyone, either stranger or citizen of the country, who eats leavened bread will be outlawed from the community of Israel. You will eat nothing with leaven in it wherever you live. You will eat unleavened bread. Injunctions relating to the Passover. Moses summoned all the elders of Israel and said to them, "Go and choose a lamb or kid for your families and kill the Passover victim. Then take a bunch of hyssop, dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and with the blood from the basin, touch the lintel and both doorposts. Then let none of you venture out of the house till morning. Then when Yahweh God goes through Egypt to strike it, and sees the blood on the lintel and on both doorposts, he will pass over the door and not allow the destroyer to enter your homes and strike. You will observe this as a decree, binding you and your children for all time, and when you have entered the country which Yahweh will give you as he promised. You will observe this ritual, and when your children ask you, 'What does this ritual mean?' you will tell them, 'It is the Passover sacrifice in honor of Yahweh, who passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt and struck Egypt, but spared our houses.' And the people bowed in worship. The Israelites then went away and did as Yahweh God had ordered Moses and Aaron. The 10th plague, death of the firstborn. And at midnight, Yahweh struck down all the firstborn in Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh, heir to his throne, to the firstborn of the prisoner in the dungeon, and the firstborn of all the livestock. Pharaoh and all his officials and all the Egyptians got up in the night, and there was great wailing in Egypt, for there was not a house without its dead. It was still dark when Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron and said, 'Up, leave my subjects, you and the Israelites. Go and worship Yahweh God as you have asked, and take your flocks and herds as you've asked, and go and bless me too.' The Egyptians urged the people on and hurried them out of the country. because they said, "Otherwise we shall all be dead." So the people carried off their dough, still unleavened, their bowls wrapped in their cloaks on their shoulders. The Egyptians plundered. The Israelites did as Moses had told them and asked the Egyptians for silver and golden jewelry and clothing. Yahweh made the Egyptians so much impressed with the people that they gave them what they asked. So they despoiled the Egyptians. Israel's departure. The Israelites left Ramesses for Succoth, about 600,000 on the march, men, that is not counting their families. A mixed crowd of people went with them, and flocks and herds, quantities of livestock, and with the dough which they had brought from Egypt, they baked unleavened cakes, because the dough had not risen, since they had been driven out of Egypt without time to linger or to prepare food for themselves. The time that the Israelites spent in Egypt was 430 years, and on the very day the 430 years ended, all Yahweh's armies left Egypt. The night when Yahweh God kept vigil to bring them out of Egypt must be kept as a vigil in honor of Yahweh by all Israelites for all generations. Ordinances for the Passover. Yahweh said to Moses and Aaron, "This is the ritual for the Passover. No alien may eat it, but any slave bought for money may eat it once you have circumcised him. No stranger and no hired servant may eat it. It must be eaten in one house alone. You will not take any of the meat out of the house, nor may you break any of its bones. The whole community of Israel must keep it. Should a stranger residing with you wish to keep the Passover in honor of Yahweh, all the males of his household must be circumcised. He will then be allowed to keep it and will count as a citizen of the country. But no uncircumcised person may eat it. The same law will apply to the citizen and the stranger resident among you." The Israelites all did as Yahweh God had ordered Moses and Aaron. And that same day, Yahweh brought the Israelites out of Egypt in their armies. A reading from Exodus 13, the firstborn. Yahweh spoke to Moses and said, "Consecrate all the firstborn to me, the first birth from every womb among the Israelites, whether man or beast, it is mine. The Feast of Unleavened Bread." Moses said to the people, "Remember this day on which you came out of Egypt from the place of slave labor, for by the strength of his hand Yahweh brought you out of it. No leavened bread may be eaten on this day in the month of Abib. You are leaving, and when Yahweh God has brought you into the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, flowing with milk and honey, which he swore to your ancestors that he would give you, then you must observe this rite in the same month. For 7 days you will eat unleavened bread, and on the seventh day there must be a feast in Yahweh's honor. During these 7 days, unleavened bread may be eaten, no leaven. Bread may be seen among you, no leaven among you throughout your territory. And on the day you will explain to your son that this is because of what Yahweh God did for me when I came out of Egypt. This will serve as a sign on your hand, would serve or a reminder on your forehead, and in that way the law of Yahweh God will ever be on your lips. For with a mighty hand Yahweh brought you out of Egypt. You shall observe this law as its appointed time, year by year. The firstborn. When Yahweh God has brought you into the Canaanite country, as he swore to you and your ancestors that he would, and given it to you, to Yahweh you must make over whatever first issues from the womb, and every firstborn cast by animals belonging to you. These males belong to Yahweh, but every firstborn donkey you will redeem with a lamb or a kid. If you do not redeem it, you must break its neck. All human firstborn, however, among your sons, you will redeem. And when your son asks you in days to come, "What does this mean?" you will tell him, "By the strength of his hand, Yahweh God brought us out of Egypt, out of the place of slave labor. When Pharaoh stubbornly refused to let us go, Yahweh killed all the firstborn in Egypt, of man and beast alike. This is why I sacrifice every male first issuing from the womb to Yahweh, and redeem every firstborn of my sons. This will serve as a sign on your hand, or would serve or a headband on your forehead. For by the strength of his hand, Yahweh brought us out of Egypt." F. The departure from Egypt, the departure of the Israelites. When Pharaoh had let the people go, God did not let them take the road to the Philistines' territory, although that was the shortest. In case, God thought, the prospect of fighting makes the people change their minds and turn back to Egypt. Instead, God led the people a roundabout way through the desert of the Sea of Reeds. The Israelites left Egypt fully armed. Moses took with him the bones of Joseph, since Joseph had put the Israelites on solemn oath with the words, "It is sure that God will visit you," he had said, "and when that day comes, you must take my bones away from here with you." They set out from Succoth and encamped at Etam on the edge of the desert. Yahweh preceded them by day in a pillar of cloud to show them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, so that they could march by day and by night. The pillar of cloud never left its place ahead of the people during the day, nor the pillar of fire during the night. From Etham to the Sea of Reeds, a reading from Exodus 14. Yahweh spoke to Moses and said, "Tell the Israelites to turn back and pitch camp in front of Pi Hahiroth, between Migdol and the sea, facing Baal Zephon. You must pitch your camp opposite this place beside the sea, and then Pharaoh will think the Israelites are wandering to and fro in the countryside. The desert has closed in on them. I shall then make Pharaoh stubborn, and he will set out in pursuit of them, and I will win glory for myself at the expense of Pharaoh and his whole army, and then the Egyptians will know that I am Yahweh." And the Israelites did this. The Egyptians pursue the Israelites. When Pharaoh, king of Egypt, was told that the people had fled, he and his officials changed their attitude towards the people. "What have we done?" they said. "Allowing Israel to leave our service?" So Pharaoh had his chariot harnessed and set out with his troops, taking 600 of the best chariots and all the other chariots in Egypt, with officers in each. Yahweh God made Pharaoh, king of Egypt, stubborn, and he gave chase to the Israelites. The Israelites marched confidently away, but the Egyptians, all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, his horsemen, and his army gave chase and caught up with them where they lay encamped beside the sea near Pi Hahiroth, facing Baal Zephon. As Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians in pursuit of them. The Israelites were terrified and cried out to Yahweh God for help. To Moses they said, "Was it for lack of graves in Egypt that you had to lead us out to die in the desert? What was the point of bringing us out of Egypt? Did we not tell you as much in Egypt?" "Leave us alone," we said. "We would rather work for the Egyptians. We prefer to work for the Egyptians than to die in the desert." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see what Yahweh will do to rescue you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. Yahweh God will do the fighting for you. All you need to do is to keep calm." The miracle of the sea. Yahweh God then said to Moses, "Why cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to march on. Your part is to raise your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, so that the Israelites can walk through the sea on dry ground, while I, for my part, shall make the Egyptians so stubborn that they will follow them. And I shall win glory for myself at the expense of Pharaoh and his chariots and horsemen. And when I have won glory for myself, at the expense of Pharaoh and his chariots and horsemen, the Egyptians will know that I am Yahweh." Then the angel of the God who preceded the army of Israel changed station and followed behind them. The pillar of the cloud moved from their front and took position behind them. It came between the army of the Egyptians and the army of Israel. The cloud was dark, and the night passed without the one drawing any closer to the other the whole night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and Yahweh drove the sea back with a strong easterly wind all night and made the sea into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went on dry ground right through the sea, with walls of water to right and to left of them. The Egyptians gave chase, and all Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and horsemen went into the sea after them. In the morning watch, Yahweh God looked down on the army of the Egyptians from the pillar of fire and cloud, and threw the Egyptian army into confusion. He so clogged their chariot wheels, they drove only with difficulty, which made the Egyptians say, "Let us flee from Israel, for Yahweh is fighting on their side against the Egyptians." Then Yahweh God said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea and let the waters flow back on the Egyptians and on their chariots and their horsemen." Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and as day broke, the sea returned to its bed. The fleeing Egyptians ran straight into it, and Yahweh God overthrew the Egyptians in the middle of the sea. The returning waters washed right over the chariots and horsemen of Pharaoh's entire army, which had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not a single one of them was left. The Israelites, however, had marched through the sea on dry ground with walls of water to right and to left of them. That day, Yahweh rescued Israel from the clutches of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the seashore. When Israel saw the mighty deed that Yahweh had performed against the Egyptians, the people revered Yahweh and put their faith in Yahweh God and in Moses, his servant. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from Psalm 32. Candid admission of sin. How blessed are those whose offence is forgiven, whose sin blotted out. How blessed are those to whom Yahweh imputes no guilt, whose spirit harbours no deceit. Pardon me. I said not a word, but my bones wasted away from groaning all the day. Day and night your hand lay heavy upon me. My heart grew parched as stubble in summer drought. I made my sin known to you, did not conceal my guilt. I said, I shall confess my offence to Yahweh God, and you, for your part, took away my guilt, forgave my sin. That is why each of your faithful ones prays to you in time of distress. Even if great floods overflow, they will never reach your faithful. You are a refuge for me. You guard me in trouble. With songs of deliverance you surround me. I shall instruct you and teach you the way to go. I shall not take my eyes off you. Be not like a horse or a mule that does not understand bridle or bit. If you advance to master them, there is no means of bringing them near. Countless troubles are in store for the wicked, but one who trusts in Yahweh God is enfolded in his faithful love. Rejoice in Yahweh. Exult, all you upright. Shout for joy, you honest of heart. The word of the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. A reading from the Holy Gospel, Matthew 15, verses 21 to 39. The daughter of the Canaanite woman healed. Jesus left that place and withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And suddenly out came a Canaanite woman from that district and started shouting, Lord, son of David, take pity on me. My daughter's tormented by a devil. But he said not a word in answer to her. And his disciples went and pleaded with him, saying, give her what she wants, because she keeps shouting after us. He said in reply, I was sent only to the house of Israel. But the woman had come up and was bowing low before him. Lord, she said, help me. He replied, it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to little dogs. She retorted, ah, yes, Lord, but even little dogs eat the scraps that fall from their master's table. And then Jesus answered her, woman, you have great faith. Let your desire be granted. And from that moment, her daughter was well again. Cures near the lake. Jesus went on from there and reached the shores of the Lake of Galilee, and he went up onto the mountain. He took his seat, and large crowds came to him, bringing the lame, the crippled, the blind, the dumb, and many others. These they put down at his feet, and he cured them. The crowds were astonished to see the dumb speaking, the cripples whole again, the lame walking, and the blind with their sight, and they praised the God of Israel. The second miracle of the loaves. But Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I feel sorry for all these peoples. They have been with me for 3 days now and have nothing to eat. I do not want to send them off hungry, or they might collapse on the way. The disciples said to him, where in a deserted place could we get sufficient bread for such a large crowd to have enough to eat? Jesus said to them, "How many loaves have you?" They said, "Seven and a few small fish." And then he instructed the crowd to sit down on the ground, and he took the seven loaves and the fish, and after giving thanks, he broke them and began handing them to the disciples, who gave them to the crowds. They all ate as much as they wanted, and they collected what was left of the scraps, 7 baskets full. Now 4,000 men had eaten, to say nothing of women and children. And when he had sent the crowds away, he got into the boat and went to the territory of Magadan. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. That's the end of day 32, the one that I got wrong. So I still have to read day 33, and I'll fit that in soon. I'm not sure if it will be this evening or tomorrow morning. But I have the other little ones to record first. Thank you for listening. Sorry it was very long. It was 36 minutes. God bless your evening, sending you the peace of Christ and blessings and healings in the name of Jesus Christ.